details of the financial offer that met the needs of the council. In total, four providers submitted proposals and an evaluation panel ranked the bidders and identified a prepared bidder. This prepared provider was evaluated on the above evidence as the best potential specialist operator to negotiate with, offering the best potential offer for the residents of Wirral and the users of the courses. A delegated decision was duly requested from the cabinet member to negotiate with the prepared provider, which would have allowed officers to negotiate with this provider to seek to agree the best deal possible for Wirral and course users to ensure the long-term future of these courses in line with the new adoption. However, this decision was called in and officers are currently following the instructions of our cabinet member to carry out more detailed judicial work in terms of engaging and consulting with stakeholders to ensure that we are fully informed before proceeding. The recommendation is to note this report, however, to assist members in any questions that are invited by from Mulligan, Programme Manager, and Damien Walsh, who's the Senior Manager for Leisure Services and Assistance.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Colin. Members, questions? Yes, Simon.
Thank you, Chair. The call-in meeting, I recall, one of the things that was agreed was that we would have a site visit to all four municipal golf courses for the committee, and that's been done as a matter of some urgency. Has any progress been made on that?
I think I might be able to answer that one. I raise this as well. First of all, I'd like to thank the cabinet member again. But not really pausing, but taking a stage further than that pause to allow this to take place. But like you, I was concerned that the officers had then sort of eased up organising our site visits. So I had a conversation yesterday, and I spoke to Michael Lester today, who's going to talk to all the chair spokes next week to organise a date for that tour. Because I think it's important that tour, our fact-finding tour goes ahead so that we are armed with that knowledge when this comes back to us in the future.
Thank you, Chair.
Any other questions? Yes, Christina?
Still in the you probably not heard the arguments about to put forward about Brighton being included to put out on the colleagues, different kettle of fish. And we know that there's plans to build on Brighton, but they're doing it against it. But crystal ball and our eyes tells the three parents and councillors that we've got problems ahead. But we ask many times, and I just know you've met many, especially on Brighton. And the late Mr. Elkington didn't take this into consideration. Well, we're now gone. We're now departed. Mr. Elkington wouldn't take this into consideration. And I was heartened because in the conversation yesterday at the same meeting, that David also remembered when he instructed people to come out to Bradford and take money, and there was a marked improvement, and I can't remember the figures, but I'm sure David does. So when we look at these golf courses, we're not comparing like with like, and I can't remember the last in the phrase, but it fails me. And we all noticed at the call-in that, strangely, the two that were looking to be put out were the two that had work done on them. Although in the budget meetings, it was denied that they'd had work done on them. So I'm just setting the scene for why a lot of us feel a little bit edgy about golf course conversation. Because we don't feel that enough, or we didn't feel like the late committee, that enough work was being done, and so we absolutely, those of us who are on the old committee, welcome, and your other colleagues around this table do, that some work is being done. But can we have assurances that it will be done in light of looking at all the possibilities on the golf courses? Because once they're gone, they're gone. And we hear all these stories about it'll take, I think Mr. Elkington said it would take 25 years to get the golf courses to a good playing standard. And we've heard
to Bradford Park and paying and not playing, are playing and not paying. And David, you might want to come in before you comment.
Just for you, Chair, I mean, that matter's been raised, as you say, by members of the committee and other members too. And I do know that we need to put some, because there's a role in the Bradford, and I do know that we put some measures in place to check that people were paying. They did produce more income. I can't recall whether the income raised covered the cost of the people doing it, but we certainly put measures in place to give out a message that people just couldn't come through the hedge from the grass, from the road, to the course and start playing. I think we have got an investment plan on safety grounds. There's a number of other courses to do with, mainly to do with staff facilities and to do with health and safety facilities. We have negotiated the cost of courses with that. There is an investment. I do know in the discussions I've had at the semi detached level about this, the ground conditions differ at each of the courses, and that covers the investment as well. So thank you.
Colin?
Okay, I'm going to answer, come back to Bradford with the Bradford in a minute, and we've got the kind of figures here. I think in terms of assurances, I did watch the webcast to make sure I was fully aware of kind of Owen's concerns and some of the arguments. We are attempting at the moment to make an arrangement with the Honorary Secretary there to meet on site to talk about the issues, because that was one of the kind of feedbacks we got from one of the witnesses that we called. So we're hoping that to take place. In terms of the assurances, Councillor McManus and I have discussed this at length, and she's very keen that we engage with this committee and that we do much more work to look at all the possible options. I will say that we still have to have in consideration the background, and we will bring all this back, the capital investments and the running costs and things, but I think we do need to do a little bit more work. To bring this back, which he wants to come this way. I think if it's okay with you, Chair, Damien's going to answer the specific question about collecting money of Bradford. Is that okay?
Fine. Yeah, thank you, Chair. I'm sorry to hear Andrew, I think this is fine.
I think you need to put your mic on.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Following on from Councillor Munster's comments and Councillor Williams' comments back in 2016, I think it was, about the suspect of people were voting on. And in fact, as David says, there's a road running through Brackenwood. Indeed, there's a road running through Warren as well, in terms of the same issue, although it's only a 9-hour golf course. We do have issues at Arrow Park with it, and we do have issues at Toilet with it as well. The ease of access, you can't fence all the way around the golf course, it's too much. Okay. And there's public footpaths through these golf courses anyway. Yeah. So we do have those problems. But following a staff negotiation exercise that we conducted with the staff, following your concerns in 16-17, we introduced a new staffing roster at each of the golf courses. In response to that, that introduced a 2 hour a day segment where they go out on the course and check people's tickets. So that 2 hour segment can happen either in the morning or the afternoon. So we don't tell people when it's going to be and we vary it. So after each course on a 2 hour basis, so they will go out and boogie and collect the income from non playing golfers. And they do it more readily in Brackenwood than anywhere else because of the ease of getting onto the course from the road. So it does happen there more often than not. First year we
consultation over this issue was not as good as it should be. So I'm heartened tonight to hear that it appears now that the current situation is being put on, I think you said, Colin, on pause while we have further consultation. And I presume further consultation will include the managers of all the golf courses, the users of the golf courses, the staff, and what we just referred to now, the trade unions. And I very much welcome, if they're going to visit these golf courses, I very much welcome the input of the trade unions as part of that visit. So I'm heartened by the report that's been given tonight. But I just want to ask the question to you, what exactly now is the timescale? We've been told that the visits to the golf courses will take place as soon as possible. But what sort of timescale are we talking about now when you talk about pause and what's happening at the moment? When are you going to come back, do you think, with any specific sort of recommendation? Any idea?
To be honest with you, I was waiting to get feedback from members tonight and make sure that we're all on the same page with this. It was my intention to obviously do the visits and support members who go to those. Matt and I will be meeting early next week to really bottom out a plan, to be honest with you, because we do need a little bit of time to think out how long this is going. We do have a programme of engagement that's already in place. It's looking at that and whether it needs to be extended and how much of that time. But I'm very happy to provide feedback to the chair and whoever has planned it, but that would assist. If you just give us a week or so to kind of talk this through, and then we can drop you an email if that's okay, Chair.
That's fine.
Thank you, Chair.
Yeah. Thank you,
Stephen. Can I just have confirmation on what you said before? 14 came first year, 12 came second.
13. 13,336 roughly, the first year.
And 12?
12 last year.
Right, and you said that was collected in 2 hour periods?
Yeah, so they have a patrol that goes out, it's part of the staff instructor, so it's an in-house thing. So the staff will do a patrol of the golf courses at each course as part of a 2 hour segment, so they'll go out and collect fees from people who are booked on.
So, it's only 2 hours a day you've got that extra.
Yes.
And presumably staffing wise it wouldn't have cost us anything because they're employed anyway.
They're employed at the ticket office to collect money, but they'll go out onto the course and collect money during that spell.
So the 13 and the 12 were net profit almost?
Yeah, the money that we did receive in 2015, 2016.
So if people were able to go out more often, we'd get more money?
Yeah, but I think it has declined over that period. I think people have started to realise that we are doing something about it. I think that figure will come down again. I don't think it's exponential in terms of the figures that we'll put to it.
Well, on Bradmore, can I just say that we are constantly being contacted by residents in Bradmore Road and in Peter Price's. Because the bunkers are, they're all parking in that road.
Yes.
And it's increasing, it's not decreasing.
Okay. Shall we take that on board?
Yes, Captain Helm.
I just want to understand a bit, sorry if you're having to repeat, but I'm not aware of the timeline. In 2014, there was soft market testing for all of the courses. And then in 2018, it was just the two that we have in front of us now. I'm wondering if, when we want to start negotiations haven't started, I'm wondering what kind of incentive it was for someone looking at an 18-hole Parkland course, Arrow Park, if the hypothesis was it's only a 9-hole Parkland course, just one motorway junction down on the M53, because the move of the Brackenwood course into the Greenbelt review, I can't seem to get any clarification on the timing of that. I just want to know if this has been modelled, if it's been discussed with anybody, because the Barrow Park isn't that attractive. Unless Brackenwood is an eye hole, then you won't even get any of it done when it's back